now a big round of applause, please, for Cameron and John from Hashicorp.
Evening, everyone. Thanks for coming. My name is Cameron Stokes. I'm a solutions engineer with Hashicorp. I'm going to speak a bit about Terraform, and then John's going to talk about Nomad a bit, and then we're going to actually do a demo. We're actually scheduling and moving workloads across Amazon and Google using Nomad and Consul for service discovery. So who's heard of, or who is using Terraform already? Sweet. Who's looking at using it or thinking about it? So Terraform is our tool for infrastructure provisioning and infrastructure management. So if you think of managing your instances, VPCs, security groups, etc., on Amazon, those kind of same resources at Google, OpenStack, etc., it's kind of a cross-provider, multi-provider infrastructure management tool. And really, the principles of Terraform is that it truly is an infrastructure as code tool and workflow. It has multi-provider support, as I mentioned. It provides a resource graph, and I'll explain what that means in a minute. And then it gives you plan and execution, distinct phases in execution for plans, and then actually applying your changes. So to start with infrastructure as code, it is, you are defining your resources in human-readable, JSON-compatible configuration language. So it's HCL, HashiCorp configuration language, which is the language that we use across Nomad, Consul, etc., Terraform as well. It's, of course, a text format, so you check it into Git or whichever VCS you're using. And it allows you to separate your configuration across multiple files and folders and so on, so you're not just stuck with, you know, one long text file of your configuration. As I mentioned, it is multi-provider, and as I'll show in an example in a bit, it actually allows you to combine multiple providers into a single set of configuration and actually relate them to each other. So again, all of the predominant and major providers, of course, Amazon, Google, Microsoft, Azure, but we also have support for CDNs, for databases, for on-premise, you know, VMware infrastructure as well.
Google's again, all on that's, your slide.
Sorry. What was the question, sorry? Sorry.
There's no Google, you said.
Oh, I missed Google, sorry.
Yes.
We have great Google support, actually, just got bumped off the list. This is not the complete list. This is probably half the list, actually. About the resource graph. So again, based on your configuration and how you relate your resources together, Terraform internally builds a graph of your resources and how they relate to each other, and then that's how it determines the order of operations in order to make changes as well. So just by you, again, referencing your resources to each other, this graph is, again, built internally, and it's not really something that you have to worry about in this, except that it defines that order. And one of the commands that's actually available within Terraform is to get a visual graph output of that resource graph so you can actually see those relations. And as you do plans or as you do runs or destroys against your resources, you can actually see where those resources intersect and will be affected by those changes. Really, really powerful feature of Terraform. Just to kind of help explain where Terraform fits in kind of the HashiCorp ecosystem, this is a bit visual about it. It's kind of in the, you know, deployment, provisioning, management space, certainly interrelated with Nomad and Consul, and certainly downstream of Packer as well.
What are the others?
The others are, so Vagrant is our tool for local development environments. Vault, as was talked about earlier, is our secrets management tool. Packer is our image building tool. Nomad for scheduling, Consul service discovery, and then Auto is one of our newer tools, which is provides a simpler interface, a kind of a more concise interface on top of the entire suite of tools. So Auto is relatively new, but getting much more advanced in the future, again, kind of encompassing the entire suite of tools from us. So specifically on the infrastructure as code idea, again, you're defining the resources and properties of your resources in a configuration language that is common across all the providers that we support, that Terraform supports. So in this example, we're actually defining an Amazon instance and a Cloudflare record, and as we can see, and maybe you can see in the highlighted section, we're actually referencing the public IP address of our Amazon instance in the value of the record that we're creating at Cloudflare. So again, this is us able to relate resources across multiple providers. And by doing so, this is actually, again, where that resource graph comes into play. Again, by defining those references, Terraform now knows that these are dependent on each other, so that when it goes to create these resources, it has to create the instance first, wait for that public IP address to be assigned or to be available before creating the record at Cloudflare. Some additional features of Terraform in your configuration are support for variables. So rather than hard coding AMI IDs, hard coding instance types, things of that nature can be extracted into variables. Variables can have defaults. They can also be provided as variables files, or they can be provided as input at the command line when you do your execution of Terraform. They can be strings or maps, and coming quite soon, you'll actually be able to define lists. There's some workarounds for lists today, but lists will be a first class variable within Terraform quite soon. So again, just illustrating variables. In the previous example, we defined the instance type of our instance as a T2 micro. Using a variable, we're able to extract that out into a variable and then replace the hard-coded instance type with just a variable interpolation there. So again, pretty simple example, but you can see how this could be applied across 100 instances, all defining the same instance type if you wanted to with a single variable. Outputs are another feature of the syntax within Terraform's configuration language. So output allows you to retrieve values off of the resources that were created, and as we'll see with modules, to retrieve values out of your modules as well. So again, an output is something that's created or computed after the resource has been created. And so public IP address of our instance is an output. It's again referenced in our Cloudflare record, but then we can also just output it in the Terraform command so that we can use it for other operations or inputs into other tools. So just with the Terraform output, I see all of my outputs that are defined or passing the actual output name, and I can just get the single value. Some meta parameters that are available are count, depends on, and lifecycle. Count actually allows you to define, or rather to instruct Terraform to create, n number of those resources. So rather than defining, again, 100 instances, you can define it once and just have a count equals 100, and Terraform will manage this for you. Depends on lets you define strict dependencies between resources if they're not actually just implicit by references. And then lifecycle lets you define that certain resources should never be destroyed or should be created before destroyed if the change requires them to be recreated. So modules within Terraform. Modules allow you to take common reusable sets of Terraform configuration and encapsulate them into a module that can be reused multiple times in your configuration. They can take inputs as variables, they can provide outputs that can be used by the rest of your configuration, and they can be sourced from either your local configuration or remote sources such as GitHub or any URL can work. So again, kind of taking the example from before, if we took that Amazon instance configuration, moved it into a separate folder, we can now reference it multiple times just by using module and have the same exact configuration repeated for all the instances created in that manner. This works really well for like common global configurations, so VPCs, DNS records, things that are maybe defined once across many different application stacks in your environment. Also centralizing CIDR blocks, AMIs, route tables, things that are common across all components within your infrastructure. So I mentioned that Terraform has multiple different modes of operation, actually multiple different commands. The plan phase is actually where Terraform will inspect your configuration, build that resource graph, and then tell you, or rather show you, what it's going to do before it does it. So this gives you a great way to essentially code review your Terraform configuration without actually making destructive changes or changes that you don't want to your live resources. So this is just an example plan based on the same configuration that we showed earlier. In this case, again, nothing has been changed, nothing has been created. Based on the configuration, based on what Terraform knows of our existing resources, this is telling us it's going to create an instance and create a Cloudflare record, again, letting us inspect the plan before actually executing it. The apply is where the changes actually occur. So again, once we've done our plan, we can see that it is performing the changes or performing the operations that we expect. We can continue on and actually perform the Terraform apply. This is where Terraform is actually going, calling the Amazon API, creating that instance, waiting for that public IP address to become available, then calling the Cloudflare API and doing the same create resource operation there. Terraform handles errors, known errors, where it can. So if, again, in that case where it creates the instance, but maybe Amazon has not assigned the IP address yet, Terraform will wait for that IP address to become available. Or if Amazon is telling us that they're busy, it will wait and back off based on a retry policy before trying to recreate that the resource at Amazon. And that second bullet point is actually really important in the sense that Terraform can, again, based on that resource graph and knowing the references and dependencies, run operations in parallel where possible. So if we're creating 100 instances that have no references to each other, it won't do 100 at a time, it'll do 10 at a time by default. It'll create those 10 in parallel so that your operations occur much, much, much faster. Again, this is just an example apply output based on the same plan that we saw before. So the plan summary before was we were going to create two, change zero, and destroy zero, and our apply is essentially telling us the same thing. It actually added two with no changes or destroys occurring. The destroy is actually, again, kind of the final operation that you might do within an environment. This is where you want to tear down, you know, everything that's defined in your configuration. It operates the same manner, in the same manner as apply, handles errors, does it in parallel, again, showing you as it's doing the destroy what it's doing. You are able to get a plan of the destroy before doing it in the same manner as you can get a plan before creating the environment or making changes, so you know exactly what's going to be destroyed before it happens. So just to wrap up, Terraform is a tool that gives you a single workflow, a single process, a single way of managing resources across multiple providers. One of its goals is to make you, your developers, your operators, your engineers confident in the changes that they're making. They can change their configuration, see the Terraform plan before actually executing those changes, so you can catch any errors, catch any changes that would require Terraform to recreate the resource. Say if you accidentally change an AMI ID, that's an operation that can't be changed at Amazon, you would have to recreate the instance. You can catch those using that Terraform plan. And when applications are getting more and more complex, given the just being in a cloud environment or just the kind of broad range of application or system types that are out there, Terraform tries to bring simplicity and, again, codification, infrastructure as code to your environments. And with that plan and with those apply, it allows you to, again, collaborate on those changes. So you can do a Terraform plan, show it to your colleague, show it to your teammate, let them review it before you actually make any of those changes. So just terraform.io is the website. There's some URLs if you're interested. John is going to come up next and talk about Nomad a bit. Then we're going to do a demo, and I'll explain the demo once when we get to it, and then we can take Q&A towards the end. This is John.
Hi, my name is John. I'm a solutions engineer at Hashicorp as well. Cool. So what I want to talk about now is Nomad. We have already had a presentation about Nomad that covered a lot of the basics. And so I'm just going to expand on it a little bit in places that I see fit. But the biggest thing and what we want to cover in the demo is how our tools can complement each other. Terraform being something that provides resources, and Nomad being something that schedules across those. So you have an orchestration platform such as Terraform that creates this pool of compute that you hopefully, rather than as you're decoupling your infrastructure into more of a microservices type world, rather than placing those apps on different VMs and paying money for EC2 instances that are underutilized, you're starting to bin pack, as mentioned earlier, more of those applications in a containerized format onto smaller, beefier resources. So you can really optimize your Amazon or GCE or whatever provider you're using utilization, and then scale as well. So with your different deployment strategies in that, if you're using an Amazon, you're deploying AMI maybe with your latest application if you're looking at an immutable infrastructure. And so baking that AMI takes time. There's places with Nomad and with different schedulers out there where instead of deploying an entire new instance to be able to deliver a new application in a safe and immutable way, you can do application level immutability where you're just changing the application that is running on underlying resources that might be provisioned by Terraform, Ansible, or any other orchestration tool in AWS specifically. So as mentioned, higher resource utilization with Nomad allows you to save money, decoupling the work from resources, right? And then better quality of service, so not having downtime, doing blue-green deploys easily, rolling back easily, all of those types of things you'd like to do in a very quick and snappy way. So with Nomad, a lot of this was already covered, so I'm not going to go quite as far into it, but just as a high-level overview, out of the box, something that Nomad strives to achieve, or does achieve, as well as Consul, is being multi-datacenter out of the box. And so if you're running a larger infrastructure, there's common scenarios where you might be cross-datacenter, cross-region, cross-provider, as we're going to hopefully show later in our demo. So multi-datacenter, multi-region, flexible workloads is a highlight. There's obviously a lot of schedulers already in the space, and a lot of people ask, Hashicorp, why did you build another scheduler? For us, if you saw that or the slide that Cameron showed earlier, it does kind of complete our pipeline in regards to what we want for good application delivery. But in addition to that, looking at the space out there, there was a lot of room for improvement in how to operationalize a scheduler. And so we took a lot of what we learned from building Surf and then building Consul and tied that into Nomad, which we'll talk about in a bit. But flexible workloads being one thing that we didn't see consistently with schedulers. So if I'm a company, whether I'm a startup or a large company, I may not have the choice to be able to define what my application type is that I want to schedule. Maybe it's a VM, maybe it's a standalone application, maybe it is a Docker container. We think that shouldn't matter. You should still be able to use the same scheduler, not have to build new frameworks for that, and not be confined to specific operating systems, and not be confined to specific containerized formatting tools. Bin packing, job priorities is a highlight as well. So I need a job to run somewhere. This one's way more important. I can up the priority, which we saw earlier, where you can change that priority level and it gets preference over some of the other ones. There's also a lot of different constraints that come into play with that, where I need a container to run on a specific node type, or I have a multi-tenant environment and I want to set on my Nomad agents that this is these types of workloads are able to be run here but not elsewhere. And so you can use those custom defined constraints, whether they're given to you by Nomad out of the box, like operating system, that's some of the fingerprinting stuff that we were seeing before, provider stuff from AWS or GCE. There's a lot of stuff that comes, that Nomad just grabs for you, and you can use those as constraints using the interpolation pieces. But in addition, just specific custom meta parameters that you define on where, what type of work can be run on this. Maybe it's just batch, or maybe it's just this specific type of workload that I built this EC2 instance or whatever instance type it is to run on. You can really define where you want your work to run. And in addition to that, with the flexible workloads, maybe it is a C# application, maybe it's Java, maybe it's a Docker container, maybe it's Kinemu, KVM, whatever it is, we want you to be able to define your application and workload type and just have it work. And so one thing that you'll see in Terraform and Nomad and a lot of our different tools is that it's a declarative language. I want to define what the Nomad job should do. Nomad figures out how to do it, and that means where to schedule it, how to best optimize the scheduling of it, setting the restart policies. If it fails, Nomad is the one that's responsible for restarting that job. Large scale, so as mentioned, Consul is very, it can scale very highly as well as Surf, and Nomad was built in that nature too. So we want you to be able to scale to whatever size that you want to, not limited based on the tool or the way that the tool is built. There's bottlenecks and other implementations. The optimistically concurrent paradigm in which we built into Nomad allows for that. And so built upon or with a lot of the same constructs as Google's Omega scheduler. And unlike some of the other schedulers, or I don't know if there's any other schedulers that are optimistically concurrent in that realm, or in the scheduler space right now. And so allowing you to still get the scalability that you want to, achieve, excuse me, and then eventually get the consistency that you need across. The last highlight item is it's operationally simple. So if anyone's run any of the other schedulers in production, there's a lot of different tools that are involved. It is a tough process and there's a lot of things moving. It's a distributed system in nature, and some other schedulers depend on other distributed systems, and you're starting to bring one, two, or three different distributed systems into play. That's hard to operationalize, it's hard to upgrade, and it's really hard to do whether you're at a small scale or a large scale. It's just a lot of things that are moving around. So out of the box with Nomad, we wanted to take the consensus that we learned and built with Consul, the gossip that we got from Surf that we've seen at high scale and worked at in data centers of 10,000 plus nodes, and bring that into the scalability of what Nomad can offer. So with that, thousands of regions, tens of thousands of clients per region, and thousands of jobs per region. So really scaling to whatever size you may need, not having that bottleneck in how you're making those scheduling decisions because of the optimistically rather than pessimistic view. So with that, I mentioned Surf is, we use the gossip protocol. It was the first tool that was built prior to Consul. Consul is built on the Surf library and is used for service discovery, as well as, you know, there's different configuration pieces that you can tie in the Consul. Some things that were previously mentioned with the how it can assist in Vault implementation, creating your configuration files based on secrets that are stored in Vault, or it has a KV store that allows to aid in that configuration. But the biggest thing with both Consul and Surf is that they are highly scalable, so we took a lot of those primitives that were built into each of these tools and put that into the consensus of how, or the consensus protocol of how Nomad should work, so using Raft as well. So Surf is a cluster management tool which is gossip based, determines membership, has failure detection, so basically you have 1, 5, 10, 100s, thousands of nodes. There's agents on each all chattering and saying, hey, I'm here, hey, are you here? All the neighbors are always talking. If someone stops responding, the cluster knows that the neighbors know that that agent stopped talking to it. So it can let the leaders know or the cluster know that, hey, this guy's not alive, he's not responding. I don't know what happened, but he's not considered healthy until he starts chattering again. As well as in the event system, so sending around information to those different nodes to trigger certain orchestration commands or letting them know. Large scale, production hardened, so this is again the first tool that Consul was built upon and has been used at the 10,000 plus node scale per data center. Surf code base hasn't been touched in quite a while. I think for 0.6 it got some updates, but you can see just based on the number of, well, one, because no one really knows what it is, but the number of issues and pull requests that are on the Surf repo is minimal because it does what it does really well, and there's, so far, there hasn't been much improvement needed in it. Operation is simple as well. So generally, Surf isn't a tool that most people run. Consul is the one that they actually are interacting with because it provides and solves that service discovery problem. So I want to know where service X is. What I can do is query Consul and it'll tell me where that is. So all those different nodes have different agents on them, and they all report to the cluster and say, hey, this is, I'm a node, I have a service X on it, and it's passing this health check on it. So it's alive and registers that with the server cluster. Now, it doesn't talk to that server cluster again until that state changes. And what you get with that is very high scalability, and that other types of service discovery tools are always checking in. So you have the bottleneck at the servers, whereas all the console agents are edge-based triggering. So I come up, I check in, I don't talk again until I fail. The reason that works is because Surf is working underneath, where if I don't, when I go down, say I'm failing my health check, all my neighbors will tell the server cluster, hey, he's not talking back, so don't send, he's unhealthy, don't send traffic to him. One of the biggest pieces with console that made it easier to use with applications is the fact that it has a DNS interface. And so you'd have to build this into your own clients with a lot of the other service discovery tools. And this is something that's out of the box with Consul. So if I'm looking for Redis, I'm no longer putting that into my application code or tasking my developers with putting that in there. I'm putting redis.service.consul. That resolves to wherever my Redis container or instance is. So with that, you get service discovery configuration, the coordination, leader election, and all that. You can use that, the locking, and all the different functionality that Consul uses on its own. You can take advantage of that. And in addition to the DNS interface, you have a rich HTTP API. So you'll see that with Vault. You'll see that with Nomad as well. And then the central servers and distributed clients, the edge-based triggering allows for that scale. Again, multi-data center out of the box. Raft is used for consensus, which is what Nomad uses as well. It's actually just built on top of Consul because we felt it was a pretty good and scalable and production-hardened implementation. And that's what kind of makes up Nomad. So with that, those as the underlying libraries that are tools that Nomad is using, you get all of the consensus and scalability from there. However, you're not actually solving the scheduling problem just yet. So we talked about the scheduling problem before and how Nomad goes about it. There's more that we can go into there, but it's getting late and we can probably just get to the demo. So I'll wrap up with these four or three pieces that I already talked about, but two newer ones that came out in 0.6 is network tomography. And this is because there's a console agent on all of your different nodes, they're always talking using Surf, you can estimate the round trip time it takes for messaging to go back and forth. So with that, and using, I forget the name of, do you know the name of the algorithm that was used?
I don't know enough about it.
But anyways, it uses this algorithm to get like the X, Y, and Z coordinates of all the different agents in your system, so you can effectively determine how far away nodes are. So are they on the same rack? Are they on the same, you know, different data centers? And this comes into play with Nomad as you're scheduling to different nodes. A question mentioned earlier was affinity, anti-affinity. When you know how far away nodes are based on the round trip time using network tomography, you can, not out of the box, or it's not in this release of Nomad, but kind of where we're going is I want to schedule things that are close together. So if I have a Redis instance, I want to schedule my Node.js servers around Redis, but I want to only schedule half of them around Redis. I want the other half as far away from Redis as possible, so that if a rack fails, then I don't have everything clustered or scheduled on one rack, and so you can get that affinity, anti-affinity problem solved with that. as well as the, and I forget the name of the feature as well, the network where you don't schedule them on the same host. I forget the actual name.
Distinct host,
that's it, thank you. And then the last one is prepared queries, and this is something that we're going to demo over here. And what that is through the DNS interface, there was a lot of cool things we can do that made it really simple for application developers to always resolve where that service is. But what operators and other people were wanting was more or richer queries. And so you can only do so much with DNS names. You can do subdomains, and we allow tagging. So, you know, node A or dot Redis dot service dot console, but you can only do so much with that. So with prepared queries, you can actually template out conditional logic on what should happen if that query that was returned didn't return a result. So the most common scenario is database failover. So if I'm in database A and I'm looking for Redis or maybe even a web server, and there's no healthy web servers available, I can have conditional logic in there that will say, go check other data centers. So check one or two other data centers. So it'll actually route that over the console WAN and pull back the IP of a node or a container or whatever that is in another data center. So you get that automatic failover, DC failover, if in fact you don't have services available. And we'll demo that in a real life scenario in a sec with AWS versus GCE. But a lot of cool stuff that you can start to do with the simple thing of DNS, but start to provide much richer conditional logic in those prepared queries. And then more to come with that in the upcoming release. It'll just be much simpler to use. So that's kind of what we are going to demo now, the biggest thing being Nomad. All the infrastructure was built with Terraform, and so the fact that we have infrastructure which is already running, that Cameron will talk about as well, it was built in AWS, built in GCE, with the connection in between, was a one-shot deploy. So it was a Terraform apply, and it brought up both infrastructures at the same time. And now what we're going to show is how you can schedule jobs across both of those and visualize them coming up and coming down and requests being propagated to the correct data center if one service isn't available. So, Cameron, go ahead here.
So as John was describing, we used Terraform to create a Nomad and Consul environment at Amazon, and a region of Amazon. Did the similar Nomad and Consul cluster in a region of Google. I used Terraform to actually create a VPN between the two environments, so our applications can talk across that VPN, regardless of which provider they're within. And then scheduled a server job within both providers, and scheduled a client job, kind of, you know, resembling a microservices architecture in both providers, and we can see how we can actually, as John said, move workloads between the two while still using Consul's prepared queries to route requests between them. So if I just do a Nomad status at my Google Nomad cluster, I can see I'm running my client and server at Google. If I do the same at Amazon, I'm running a cache job for collecting metrics, but I'm also running my client and server jobs at Amazon as well. And then I've got just a, once this connection comes back, I've just got a just a simple application that will watch Redis or rather pull those metrics just to kind of help visualize this environment. Let me see if I can get a connection to that box. There we go. So hopefully this will help a bit. So again, we have account. That's going off the side a bit. The numbers aren't super important, except to show that we have three. Client jobs running at Amazon, three server jobs, et cetera, across both providers. And the clients, again, are using Consul's prepared query interface, rather the DNS interface to a prepared query to discover the server that they should be talking to. So within Google, I can essentially do the same thing to kind of show what that looks like. I'm just going to do a dig against my web server prepared query, and the response is my three local web services or web server instances within Google. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to stop my web server job within Google. Whoops. We'll see in the top window that my node server account within Google has dropped to zero. So no more web server running in Google, but my client is still sending requests or trying to send requests to that server. So again, if I just do a nomad status, we can see that only the client's running. If I do my dig again at this point, so again, this prepared query is going to console. Since that job is now removed, the registered service within console within Google is removed as well. So console no longer sees that there is a web server service running in Google. And if I do a dig, you can see I still get a response, except the IP addresses have changed at this point. Scroll up, I was all on the 10.11 range, now I'm on 10.10. So 10.10 is actually my environment at Amazon. 10.11 is my environment at Google. So my client is still running, still sending requests to the web server. It's just getting addresses back in that service lookup via DNS and redirecting those requests to Amazon. So I have my clients running, I had my servers running across both providers. I've removed Google, so my clients are now just pointing to the single provider. If I actually do a dig using the normal service interface for my service, I'm going to get essentially an empty response. So this is not taking into account that prepared query. So essentially within console's regular service catalog, there are no web servers still running within Google, so I don't get a response. So again, prepared queries are what are allowing us to essentially load balance across both of the providers. So again, on my client, if I do a run on my server job again, we'll see that Nomad is now scheduling my server job within Google. And we're back to running. And you can see my node counts have readjusted. If I do my dig against my prepared query, we're now back to the 10.11 range, which is at Google. So again, as quickly as those services become registered within the clusters at either provider, the prepared query switches back to the local instances for those services.
And that's Nomad with the console block within its job file. So Nomad is actually doing that service registration and the health checks associated with it. So
just to show one other example, we're running three clients at Google. I can just change that to six. Do a Nomad run client. See, Nomad has accepted the job, is now scheduling those nodes. And we should see that client count at your request one pop up to six. Yeah, that's essentially it. Any questions?
Can you show the query?
The query? Yeah. Good question. So it's this is just the script that's essentially setting it up. So let me pull this out into a separate doc. So. John, you want to explain this since you've created this?
Yeah, so the name that it's targeting, and this is some stuff that's going to come in later version, a later version of console, but it's saying for this web server service name, I want this prepared query tied to it. So anytime I register a service under the name web server, I also get this additional logic, or sorry, the service, not the name is specific to the prepared query, but service. The name that I'm targeting. So anytime a service registered with the name web server, if there's not a result turned in the returned in the local data center, it's going to use this logic and saying I want to fail over to the nearest three data centers. So in this case, we only had one other data center that I could fail over to, and it did appropriately. But if I had like multiple regions set up, maybe it goes to the nearest one. So nearest again taking into it's using the distance between the different agents, knowing how close the closest data center is, so it's going to fail over into that closest data center. And if that one's not available, there's not a service there, it'll go to the next one until it can return something, hopefully. This is the conditional logic, so only nodes that are passing their health checks. Maybe you don't want that. Maybe you, if there's anything available, I just want to send it to that. And in the worst case scenario, tags is global, so if you set up tags on your service registration, which you can do in your Nomad job file, you can also target specific tags. So in this instance, it's just global, but you can have things like exclamation point experimental or just master or just whatever tags you can configure. So that's how you can do more conditional logic based on the tagging. And then the TTL you can do with the DNS return. So that's basically it. So more to come with prepared queries.
Oh, these nodes that were mentioned, are these like Docker containers or like physical like instances?
So that's a good point.
Yeah, in this setup, so we launched instances in Amazon, we launched instances at Google, so virtual machines at both providers, and the actual applications that we're running are just Go binaries.
Oh, Go binaries.
So you guys mentioned using the exec driver, that's what this is using, is that exec driver rather than Docker.
Yeah, so you, I see you're using Terraform to deploy these instances in Google Cloud and Amazon AWS, yep. And then you're saying an amount of these Go binaries. Right.
We're using Nomad to schedule the actual Go binaries themselves. Yeah.
One thing beyond that, so right now it's the artifact that you can point to with the exec is specific to a binary, but in ODEP 3.1, I believe you're able to just target like S3 tar.gzs or zip files. So that's where, let's say I don't necessarily want to use driver, but I still want this containerized environment to run a jar file or whatever else is compiled into this zip file. You can do that with Nomad and Node 3.1, where you're just pointing to an artifact, and then you know it still provides the same isolation C groups that Docker does, but it just does it for you.
I have one more question about this. Is it like so data persistence? Like, is this only non-persistent applications, or?
So volume support is coming in ODEP 4, and that's going to be across all drivers. And so whether it's Docker, whether it's exec, raw exec, or Java as well, I think we'll solve that problem. As we were talking earlier, I don't know yet how they're going to solve it or what the implementation spec is there, but that's what the focus for ODEP 4 is. ODEP 5 will be a focus on Vault. So piggybacking on the presentation earlier, Vault is a great way to store your secrets, and it does so with that leasing mechanism. But you haven't quite solved the security problem completely until you're actually getting those secrets to the instances that are using them in a secure way. So the secure introduction problem. And that always ends up being in your orchestrator, whether that be Terraform or Nomad. So in the next release of Terraform, and then I think in ODEP 5 for Nomad, there will be Vault as first-class support for Vault. So it'll actually talk with Vault, use the cubbyhole backend to get a temp token, thread that through to either the container or whatever is being provisioned, and then as the instance is being provisioned, it actually goes to the cubbyhole backend, grabs the permanent token, and places that in either console template or wherever it needs to be. So that temp token is something you can store on disk or store in instance metadata or whatever. It doesn't need to be as secure as where the permanent token actually exists. And so that's where, to your presentation, once you do have that token, you can put it in something like console template or wherever needs it to actually go fetch what secrets you need. So now I need my database secrets, now I need ERP credentials, now I need my IAM credentials, that kind of stuff. So roadmap-wise, that's what's coming up, is solving that secure introduction problem after the volume thing. The community's been pretty loud about volumes, and I can't use this in production until volumes exist. Makes sense. That's coming up.
I have a few more questions, but they're related to the previous presentation, mm-hmm. So about Terraform.
Okay.
Two to your question. The first question is, in January, I plus one issue. For a Ansible provision, and is there a reason why it's still not being shared?
Mainly the volume of plus ones and contributions and issues that Terraform gets. So we've got three people working full time on Terraform at this point. So hopefully you've seen some pickup and kind of momentum within the project. Maybe not every single issue, but it's mainly just, it's a very popular project, and making sure that we focus on bugs as well as enhancements is just difficult for a popular project like that. So
pull request to approve them as plus ones.
That's why I mentioned Go, you know, like, it's important.
Yeah.
Can I make a suggestion about this? Because I have the same issue using a Terraform. I must admit, incidentally, because we do our own stuff. But you can actually query with a simple script the state file of Terraform. And if you then transform the JSON to a Terraform format, you can make this script executable, and then you have an Ansible dynamic inventory. And then it's an orthogonal problem.
You have to do that all the time. You have to do that all the time.
And you need to separate these problems. So the whole concept,
exactly.
I mean, when Mitchell made Vagrant, he was only 7 years old. So you can't blame the guy. But in fact, it's an orthogonal problem. So you don't need a provisioner, or you don't need a configuration management plugin for your infrastructure provisioner. Because you can let your infrastructure provisioner tell you the IP addresses and the passwords or the keys, and then your configuration management system can take over. So,
or the other way around, you can use Packer to build the damage using Ansible.
If you have time,
In
addition to that, there's one other workaround that you can do, and that's putting all the different roles and playbooks and everything you need for Ansible to run on the machine that's being provisioned. And then just use remote exec to kick that off. And so right now there's a chef provisioner that basically does that for you. What's that?
Just remove it.
Yeah, exactly. And so everyone's like, oh, when's the Ansible provisioner coming in? And essentially you can just do it yourself, but it just makes it a little bit nicer.
You
as
need
a
to
provisioner.
Get it, you know, on there. So this
thing. Yeah, you can use cloud in it, and use a lot of cloud in it for a lot of provisioning stuff instead of remote exec. I don't have connection to it.
The instance Terraform inventory is differential.
Yeah.
Which only works for blue resources, but it's for the rest it's useful. I use it to set up a demo environment.
Yeah, but you just have neat IP addresses from the output, and you can create your own Ansible inventory file.
Yeah.
And you can do it by now.
You can do it already there.
Yeah.
We are writing as a project that is exactly trying to achieve this, so maybe it's not about it.
Yeah, what? Okay. So the question is address.
Yeah, you've got to read this one. So.
We're going to have another beer after this. Let's get some measure.
Is it possible to, or you think that the skates are on price?
Skates are on price?
Yeah, so just seeing people having a Black Friday, and Google's Day.
So that's really interesting. There's a company, I think they're out of France, called Cloud Screener, and they determine the prices of which it takes or which it costs to run different size EC2 instances. And so there's opportunity there to like hit their API and be like, hey, what's the cheapest thing? And schedule based on that. Different stuff like that. As far as us offering that, I don't.
You can provide your own like attributes on nodes when you provision them, and then constrain jobs based on those attributes. And those constraints can actually be not just equality, but like greater than, less than, whatever. So you can kind of build that yourself in the sense that you can launch instances on a C3 8XL and tag it as expensive or give it an expensive attribute, and then constrain jobs that way. So it's kind of, you'd have to again build that in, but it's achievable.
Yeah, of course. I have a question about Turbo, but I just want to know about that. Have you ever considered doing some kind of API stuff in Terraform? Because right now it's a very command line tool. If you want to automate your stuff using Terraform, then you run into kind of the trouble of executing commands. So you're faking the API around it, is what we do all the time. But is there an idea of having this native solution?
We've definitely heard of people actually, you know, wrapping Terraform, even in their own Go, library. Being a command line tool, it's not really a like service that's running that's suitable for an API necessarily.
Yeah, I think that's a good point that it's not a long running service that you can call into,
right.
But I guess you can, as you guys, it sounds like you did, just create one.
If there aren't any other questions, don't forget we are running a conference in June. And if you want to submit a paper, I think we extended the call for papers another until end of today, tomorrow. So we're still accepting proposals for talks. And we'll stick around if there are other questions afterwards.
It's just said, like, the answer to like two questions, but I actually only asked the first one.
All right.
The second one was about the configuration language. I find the order of execution to be a little bit odd. Like, I think it's like alphabet based or something.
For which specifically?
For the
config file?
The config file,
So if there are not references between resources, it may just go alphabetically, but if you have, you know, explicit references or even using like a depends on configuration, you can make that explicit so that it's going in the order that you expect or that you require.
Okay. Maybe I'm thinking like a little bit too traditional with like includes or something, you know.
Okay. Now we go to Terraform. So this interpolation thing, it's pretty nifty because sometimes you need to dynamically generate some stuff. But I personally have been really struggling with it because actually you're sort of integrating a template language and a infrastructure provisioning language, and it's really hard to sort of debug because all sorts of runtime stuff happens. Mm-hmm. And I was suffering so. I think it's awesome too, right? Let's be honest, it's great stuff and it's really innovative. But should the sort of generation of the Terraform definition of the infrastructure, so the declarative definition, not be a separate step between having a template that generate with your templates or Jinja or whatever you like, right? Then generate your Terraform definition declaratively, you can inspect it, no runtime issues, whatever, you can debug it, transform template to the state file, and then apply it. So is that something you hear more often? Because I have a feeling that would be sort of the same approach, because I was struggling with interpolation.
The problem is that it's not always possible, because it always gives you an IP address after the instance has been put out.
So you could do interpolation for some things, but now you get pull requests or feature requests, like can you give me if-then logic and all kinds of crazy stuff, right? And where's the end, right? So can you really decide this is inherently used at runtime, maybe the IP address or some count value, and that's it. Not all the other stuff, not this variable passing, and then you have all these modules and all that stuff, right? Because I think it's not truly modular. It's my personal experience, but you hear a lot of customers, so what's your idea?
In regards to debugging, or in regards to, I feel like there's a few questions in there. Debugging-wise, that's definitely...
I find it super hard to make modular Terraform things.
Is it
the same experience?
And you can simulate lists, and that's
so. I think to your point, like having to do the comma-separated stuff, like pass stuff in and pull stuff out, is that some of it? So some of that's coming in 0.7 is being able to pass maps. That's a big one where people have to do these crazy interpolation with joins and splits and concats and all that.
But it remains crazy. So suggestion that it's not true. I don't know what the truth is, but. This whole interpolation is an orthogonal problem. If you can let people do templating with whatever tools, and you can design best practices, and then you end up with a Terraform design state thing that is declarative and does as little interpolation as possible.
So I think that is doable today. So the inputs into Terraform can be HCL or JSON, so you could actually build the JSON yourself using this template language or Ruby or Python or however you want to do it, or doesn't matter, and then provide that JSON to Terraform so that you've already defined the variables or interpolated them or
exactly.
Et cetera. That's available today.
So it's technically possible, but the thing is,
what is the best practice, right? I mean, if you guys can help us become more effective,
sure,
on discovering these best practices, it would make my life better. So this
we're
is
here for it.
Do you hear this more often? I struggle with modularity, I struggle with interpolation.
We definitely hear specifically about the modules, so there's there is some work needed there to come to make them a bit more robust. I think that is coming. I haven't seen like the ideas of what Paul and the team and Clint and so on are kind of working on there, but that is a known complaint or a known issue that those just need a bit more work.
So it's definitely top of mind, especially as you mentioned the debugging things. So actually figuring out where in the heck this is failing and why is a focus coming up. So being able to debugging and figuring out why stuff isn't working.
But you do feel that this is part of something that should happen when you apply a plan, this installation, that it cannot be done in a staged way. That
in some cases it has to be.
Yeah, I think I don't foresee that changing anytime in the near future. I think that having that interpolated and declarative language makes it, certainly has its downsides, but makes it easier to manage that configuration in the long run and easier to reason about just as an engineer looking at it and maintaining it. That's not to say it couldn't be more debuggable or easier to troubleshoot when it's not producing the plan that you expect. But I don't see kind of that path from the declarative language to the plan and apply changing, at least in the near future.
Cool. Any other questions? If not, we'll be hanging around after. Whether you want to talk about stickers are also here.
Finally! We have a boatload of stickers as well.
Other tools, best practices, roadmap items, where we think stuff is going, just feel free to reach out to us. And if we can't talk today, you want to put our emails up there? Maybe we can put our emails up there. And then you can just reach out to us and we can talk and provide that. We're certainly happy to do so. Just need to open up that line of communication.
Cool, we've got a applause, please.